Today's episode of The Anthony Anderson Show is brought to you by Mezze Grill, that's MEZEGrill.com, and CarpeVM.com, that's CarpeVM.com.
Perennial polyculture, annual monoculture.
Greetings, everyone. This is Anthony Anderson coming at you live from New York City. It's a beautiful Saturday. I believe it is sometime in September, early September. I guess it doesn't even really matter. But the point is, we are here today with an honored guest, Mr. Philip McCluskey of philipmccluskey.com. Philip, how you doing, brother?
Hey, how's it going, Anthony? Thanks for having me on your show.
Yeah, man. Very cool. It's about time. Good to have you on. So Philip and I have been friends and partners in the raw food scene, along with Drew Mill and Vanessa of Gnosis Chocolate. And it was kind of like us four doing some events, and we were holding retreats, and it was just like a really good time. So we've been doing that since about 2007. And Philip has an awesome story. He's had a major transformation with switching his diet and his lifestyle up. And so I really wanted to have him on the show so he could share some inside tips and what he's been up to and things that he's doing now. He's touring all over the world. He's a world-renowned speaker on living foods, exercise, weight loss. So we'll have at it, man. How's it going?
It's amazing. I'm actually up here in Jasper, Alberta.
Cool.
In Canada, and just a sunny day and beautiful, surrounded by mountains. It's amazing.
What brings you up to Canada?
Spending a little time with my girlfriend and just a little bit of a downtime before I go on my next tour, which starts up in October in Australia.
Wow, very cool, very cool. What brought on the desire to go to Australia and do a tour down there?
You know, I've really been inspired to go for a long time, and one of the things that I like to do when I tour is to go to places that are kind of unique and that I haven't been to before. You know, one of my intentions is also to get in a lot of travel, culture, experience, meet new types of people that I probably wouldn't have normally met if I just, you know, stayed in my own area. So I like to create opportunities like that kind of broaden my exposure, but at the same time, you know, it's definitely a place that that's in need of a little bit of raw food help. Right now, the ratio, I believe, is 68% of men in Australia are overweight. Maybe not overweight like we are in the United States, where there's such a large amount of obesity, but overweight all the same. And it's still fairly new there, the raw food and the movement and kind of a little bit of the idea behind that. So it's a perfect market. I've met some friends over there, and we decided to give it a go. So yeah, that's how it came about.
And you're also teaming up with Sun Warrior for this, right?
Yes, Sun Warrior raw protein powder, which I love. They're teaming up. They're doing website and design and helping really push the tour, and really grateful for that.
Yeah, awesome. That's sunwarrior.com. If you guys don't know, really great protein powders, a lot of superfoods. They're teaming up with Philip for promoting his Australian tour, so keep an eye open for that. So backing up a little bit, how did all of this come about? I mean, now you're traveling the world, speaking about your experiences, inspiring tens of thousands, if not more, people. How did you get to this point?
Well... I'll give you the short of the long story.
Okay.
Basically, maybe about 5.5-6 years ago, I had got to a max point in my life where my weight just was officially out of control. Now, it was pretty much out of control the majority of my life. I've been overweight probably since the age of 5. You know, literally going from being the cute, you know, chubby kid who everybody wanted to pinch my cheeks and of course I wanted to slap them, then it went to being, you know, overweight, and then obese, and then they had to create a new term called morbidly obese.
Yeah.
Until finally I got to a point where I stepped on the scale one day, and the needle went to 400 pounds, and it was kind of, it kind of felt like I walked into a doctor's office, and the doctor just gave me some sort of terminal disease. He was just like, okay, you have X, and you're either going to live now, or you're not, you know, because I always think about this quote I heard a long time ago. It said that there's, you know, two things that you don't see in life. One is an old drug dealer, because generally they're in jail or dead, and the other is an old obese person, because they're just not alive, you know? And, and I already had started to feel some of the health issues coming on in a very strong way, as you can imagine. And so it got to the point where I just really knew that it was now or never. I either was going to be saying yes to life and embracing it, or I was going to continue to just rot away, so to speak, until I passed away. And that's right around the time when I had discovered raw food and made a big drastic change in my life.
What were some, I remember you saying that you've tried a lot of different methods before raw food. What were some things that you had been delving into?
Yeah, I literally had tried probably 30 different diets. I mean, every major diet I've done, whether it was, you know, some of those old school programs where you'd have this little booklet and you had protein cards and you would have to take the card after you ate a protein from the day from one slot and put it into the other, and then you couldn't eat protein for that day.
Yeah.
You know, that just the old corny stuff, all the way up to, you know, doing Weight Watchers 4, 5, 6 times. I even tried vegetarian at a point and being vegan. Of course, all the fad diets, Atkins, and that type of stuff. I mean, I went to therapists, counselors, hypnotists. I just kind of went through the whole gamut, and nothing seemed to work. I mean, there was even a time where I was working out at the gym an hour before work, and then after work, after doing a full day of work, going back to the gym to do another hour. And, you know, I definitely was burning a little bit, but I could never lose more than 20 pounds. And so nothing seemed to be working. And at the very last moment, you know, the only thing the doctors really recommended, of course, was, you know, surgery. It's just like, okay, you can't do this, so go ahead and get gastric bypass surgery. And I thought, you know, okay, maybe this is the option for me. I went through a month of tests to sort of satisfy my insurance company to actually pay for this crazy invasive procedure where they're going to cut me open and make my stomach the size of my hand and this craziness. And at the very last moment, I had gotten approved and I was about to have it done. And that's when I discovered, you know, raw food. That's when I discovered healthy eating. And that's all when everything, you know, instantly switched in a moment's time.
Yeah. So were you in a relationship at this point, or were you single?
At that point, I was married.
Okay.
And I was married, and I just... it was funny that you mentioned that, because my wife and I had gone to Germany, and it was pretty dramatic, because there was, you know, one thing I noticed at one point was people were staring at me, especially in Berlin. You know, it was very fashionable there. I just figured, hey, maybe I'm not wearing the right clothes or something like that, you know? But people were staring and, like, pulling at their friend's sleeve pointing at me.
Yeah.
And I was like, what's going on? You know, I was always, like, a tough, aggressive guy. I wasn't used to that. But I couldn't figure it out. And then later on, we went over to the Netherlands, and we were in a little bed and breakfast, and I came downstairs to use the phone because our room didn't have a phone. And when I walked in, the lady that was behind the desk, the receptionist, she didn't say hi, she didn't greet me, she didn't do anything. The only thing she did was she looked up, she looked at me, and she just exclaimed really loudly. She's like, how did you get so big?
Wow.
And she wasn't trying to be mean, she was just actually concerned. And we had a little talk for about, you know, 2 minutes, and I left. And that's when I realized, oh, wow, those people weren't looking at me because of my clothes. Those people were looking at me because of my size, because so many people there are just trim and in shape. I mean, I saw, you know, 95-year-old women out on their bikes biking around, and, you know, 80-year-old women coming from the store with their groceries in the basket in the front of their bike. And it was just such a different culture. And basically that shock kind of got into my system, and I just kept thinking about, how did you get so big? How did you get so big? This idea sort of just kept resonating in my mind. And when I came back to the United States, I decided to answer that question for myself. And instead of going and having the gastric surgery, I made the switch to healthful eating, and that really made the difference.
What was the style of your diet when you got into the living foods lifestyle?
Well, previously it was probably the worst imaginable. I was eating anywhere from 5,000 to 7,000 calories a day, easy. I remember going to Dunkin' Donuts in the morning on the way to work and thinking, okay, I want to get something to eat, because I didn't eat anything, because I didn't take the time to make food for myself, because I was probably tired from the night before. and just, you know, always out of breath and overwhelmed. And so I remember pulling in and saying, okay, let's get a muffin. A muffin can't be that fattening. Oh, maybe I'll get a corn muffin. Corn must be good, right? Mm. So I started getting two corn muffins, and then people at work were drinking these things, you know, coffee coladas. So I went and got a large one of those, and I got into a habit of just doing that every single day, two corn muffins, a large coffee colada. And I remember one day for fun, somehow I was inspired to go on their website to just check out the calorie content. And I realized that the muffins were 500 calories each.
Whoa.
The coffee colada was 700 calories. I was having 1,700 calories. I was probably having almost my daily caloric intake for my size before I even stepped into work in the morning.
Yeah.
And then, of course, you know, went out for lunch during work. I didn't prepare any meals, so it was always fast food. I'd go to McDonald's or Burger King with my $5 and stand in front of the dollar menu and just be like, three hamburgers, you know, a French fry and a milkshake.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, I don't even know how many calories that was, but I used to be so tired that when I would go back to work, my biggest fear in work was that my boss would walk in and find me asleep on my keyboard, because I would just fall asleep all the time. I couldn't even stay awake.
Yeah.
My body's like, please just shut down. Like, we don't want you to kill yourself. Just shut down. And I'd just be falling asleep with drool on my keyboard.
Yeah.
And then, of course, I was so exhausted from the day that on the way home, I couldn't even think of making food. So I'd pick up a calzone, a large pizza, a grinder, you know, some kind of chicken parmesan grinder, and just pack it in again with chips and soda and ice creams. And it was tough, man. I just remember thinking I'd come home from work with my food, and I only had one flight of stairs to get to my house. And by the time I walked those one flight of stairs, I was so winded and out of breath and even sweating, the only thing that I could really do was go sit on my couch, recline the chair, put a movie in, and like rest the food on my stomach.
Wow.
And that's what I would do. I would eat until I went to sleep or passed out on the couch, and then would wake up and, you know, go to bed later on.
And you were doing this for years.
Yeah. And it wasn't a very exciting life, as you can imagine.
Yeah.
But yeah, it had become a habit, unfortunately.
Yeah. I'm sure you watched a lot of good movies, though.
I was a movie expert, bro, because I didn't watch any TV. I didn't really get on with TV very well.
Right.
I didn't like the commercials. I didn't like the programming. So what I would do is I would just only watch movies that I loved. And I mean, it was literally 4 hours of movies every night, and Saturdays and Sundays was like an 8 to 10 hour movie marathon.
Wow.
That was it. I remember going into the movie store, and the guy looked at me, and we became friends, and he said at one point, he goes, you're not even looking to find a new movie. You're looking to find a movie that you've watched the second or third or fourth time over, because you've watched all the movies we have in here.
Yeah.
And I was like, you know, you're actually right.
Well, man. On a side note, the Anthony Anderson Show is now available on podcast, so you can see the videos and the audio. You can watch this episode on your iPhone, at home, on the train, whatever you need. Go to onlyonetv.com and you'll see all the information right there. That's really like a new thing. We really want to be able to access this kind of information as soon as possible and wherever possible. So how about diabetes? Was that ever a concern?
Thankfully, I never had diabetes. My sister had diabetes, although she wasn't overweight, and it was pretty extreme.
Uh-huh.
She actually passed away from it.
Oh.
The majority of her life, she couldn't drive because of her eyesight was so bad.
Yeah.
My father, who was also overweight, had a triple bypass heart surgery, 3 types of cancer, and got diabetes. But I guess I nipped it right in the bud. I mean, I was probably borderline. I was dealing with other things, like I couldn't breathe and terrible acid reflux. I mean, painful acid reflux. And even acid reflux that was so terrible, it would come up in the middle of the night, go back down the wrong tube, and it would block my breathing. And I would wake up recognizing that I might have not even been breathing for the last 15 seconds. And I'd have no air in my lungs, and I would just freak out and start running around my room like a chicken with his head cut off, just trying to get a breath.
Wow.
And then eventually something would clear up, and I would be like, and it was just like, oh my God, like I'm going to live type of thing. That happened to me about 5 times, and that was probably some of the scariest moments of my life. And that's kind of also some of the reasons why I just recognized, man, I got to make a change, because it's like now or never. I mean, never went outside. Going outside meant sweating profusely, and that wasn't a very appealing to me, which would turn into like rashes in my arms, my legs, and stuff like that. So there was a lot of other things. Didn't really move into diabetes probably I don't know if I was so heavy on sugars in general, but just lots of masses of meat and garbage and stuff, which I know has sugar in it as well, but diabetes never was the issue, thankfully.
So was your wife at the time, was she kind of enabling you about this, or was she trying to push you towards a more positive lifestyle?
I think, if I'm going to be really honest, I definitely am somebody, I'm the type of person that, you know, when I get in my zone, there's not too much that can push me off, spouse or otherwise.
Yeah.
So it's not that she was like saying, here, let's eat fat food all the time. She would love to see me exercise and stuff like that and eat some healthful foods, but I just wasn't in the position to do it and just was so utterly unhappy with life that... You know, it was just kind of like, you know, I accept you where you are, and if this is your choice, then so be it.
Yeah.
But later on, when I switched to raw, there was definitely much more support there.
So when you made the switch, what was the initial diet like?
Yeah. So basically, I came back from Germany, and I had been reading about water fasting for a while, and in there was a term raw food, and so I said, okay, that sounds interesting. I Googled it, found out about it, and it was the first thing that really resonated with me. It just made sense. It was natural. It's a man's first diet. Before we discovered fire, we ate our foods, you know, raw. And so I always thought, well, that's an interesting concept. And so I went out and literally went to Amazon.com, ordered like 20 books, devoured them. I mean, I didn't really eat them, but I read them all. And I was just so amazed by it at that time. I mean, I was sold times 100.
Yeah.
I switched to 100% raw vegan overnight, didn't look back, sticked on that for over 5 years, and just maintaining that distinctive. And basically what it was is, I had noticed that when I had switched to raw and started reading the books, there were so many different philosophies and ideas. You know, some people would say you need to be a fruitarian. Some people would say, oh, you need to mono meal. Some people say natural hygiene, or you need 50% of your diet to be in superfoods, or you need to juice, or you need to do smoothies. And it was just so much information and kind of a little bit of conflict as well.
Oh, yeah.
That I just decided, listen, I have to do this my way. I've done this everyone else's way. I've heard about every single diet I've tried. I've been told what to do. Felt totally disempowered my whole life. If I'm going to do this, I have to do this my way. It's the only way it's going to work. And so I created a rule for myself. And the rule was, you can eat whatever you want as long as you stay 100% raw. So in the beginning, I mean, I was making the most ridiculous size salads ever. The only way I can think about it is, when you go to an Italian restaurant and it's kind of like family style and there's like six of you and they put the salad bowl and it's for the whole table, like that was my salad for lunch and that was my salad for dinner, like that size salad. I mean, I had anywhere of upwards of 10 handfuls of nuts in one bowl of salad. I mean, I'd have 2 to 3 avocados per salad.
Yeah.
And at the time people were like, oh no, you can only have 3 avocados a week. Well, I was having 3 in a salad, and the weight was just flying off me faster than I could ever have imagined. I mean, I remember after the first 3 months, I was standing on the scale with my wife in the hospital, and I couldn't use my scale at home. It didn't go high enough. I couldn't use the scale at my doctor's office because it didn't go high enough. I had to go to a special unit in the hospital that had these big electric scales, and I remember just standing on it, and I started at 400 pounds and I stood on it and we looked at it and I was just like, oh, you know, it obviously hasn't reset from the previous person. So I got back off, we pressed the reset button, I get back on and this number appears again. And I was just like, wait a minute, unplug it. There's something wrong because it was digital. So she unplugs it, plugs it back in, it resets. And I step on it again and both of our jaws just drop because we realized the reality. I mean, I had tried so hard before and couldn't lose more than 20 pounds. And here, I mean, I literally did zero exercise for the first year I switched to raw because I was just so big. But with the diet change alone, I had lost like 55 pounds in 3 months. My clothes were falling off me. I was just in shock and awe. But at the same time, it was kind of like the snowball rolling downhill, building up momentum. And it just got me more excited to go for it in an even stronger way. And that's kind of what really kept me going.
Wow, that's awesome. I mean, especially without, I mean, it just, it's almost like magic, you know, the way you describe it. So you went from those kind of like the big salads, and then you're really well known for the juice feasting. So how long did that come about? Like, what was the process?
Sure. Well, the salads, you know, I just knew that intuitively everything would change. And so after a while, you know, having 10 handfuls of cashews just didn't feel so good anymore. Uh-huh. And so my body naturally just adjusted, and I was just like, okay, this doesn't feel good. And before, when I would have to have, you know, 2 avocados minimum per salad, I mean, I would notice that sometimes a week would go by and I hadn't even bought any avocados. Things had changed. My portions got dramatically smaller because I was starting to assimilate the food and getting more into me for the first time in my life. I mean, back in the day, I could eat a Whopper and be hungry 15 minutes later because my body's like, thanks, I don't know what you gave us, but you didn't give us anything that we actually wanted.
Yeah.
So we're just going to pass that through you, and we're still, you know, hungry for these vitamins, these minerals, and blah, blah, blah. And
right.
Now here I am blasting my body with spinach and kale and just goodness every day and smoothies. That I think that's how I really transitioned back to the smaller meals. And then I said, okay, what's next? What do we do after this? Like, I feel like I've gotten this under my belt and it feels really good. The first year went by, I had lost 100 pounds in the first year with just the diet change alone. And then I said, okay, round 2, we're here, we are in the second year. How can I up this? How can I really, you know, face fears and you know, see what kind of challenges there are? And so I heard about this idea of this 92-day juice fast.
Right.
And it just seemed crazy. I mean, like, who does juice for 3 months? Well, you know, I'm a Scorpio, I'm an extremist, so I'm like, okay, yeah, I'll do it. I literally made the decision overnight and switched and did, and it ended up being 100 days that I did it for, and I literally just had juice for 100 days. And during that time, I mean, I lost 55 more pounds. I finished at the end of the second year. The second year, I lost another 100 pounds, literally cutting my weight in half in 2 years.
Jeez.
From 400 to 200 pounds. But the juicing just blew my mind because, I mean, I was literally having things happen to me physically that I didn't even know were possible. I mean, the only way I can describe it is, without sounding, you know, overly esoteric, is it almost felt like I was having a born-again experience because the sky seemed bluer and the trees were greener. I mean, I remember driving down the street and actually having to pay attention to the road because everything felt so magnificent.
Yeah.
And my vision was just so clear. I mean, I was seeing out of the left and the right peripheral and then this middle space here and then way, way back. I was seeing that all at once, all in detail.
Yeah.
And, you know, I know a lot of times in the raw food world, people say like superhuman and all this stuff and joke around, but I really started to feel like that, and I had such clarity in my mind and was just getting new information kind of downloaded into myself that I knew that I didn't even have previous knowledge of, and it was really quite an amazing experience.
Wow. Let's take a quick break for our sponsors. MeziGrill.com, where authentic Mediterranean food meets modern flavor. They're now serving breakfast as well. They're on 8th Avenue at 55th Street in New York City, and there's worldwide franchising opportunities available, and they also just recently made the NYC Clean Plates Edition. So it's really clean food. Check it out for sure. And Carpe VM, seize your market, say it with video. Carpe VM is owned by Charlie, and he works closely with you from beginning to end to ensure that your video makes an impact. Video on the web is ideal to engage your viewers and build up your business. All right, very cool. So back to that, I'm glad you really covered the emotional awakening, because that was something that I really felt too. Like, at first it was for physical, but then it's like you're blasted past all this stuff, and
yeah.
And the juicing really brought that on more so.
Yeah, the juicing was amazing. You know, so many people that start raw or start juicing, one of the things they always get into talking about is, oh, how was the detox? And how do you go from eating 5,000 to 7,000 calories? And you must have had the most incredible detox. And, you know, sure, there was a little bit of physical detox, probably less on my side because I was just eating so many fats in the beginning. But what I did notice is I had the most incredible emotional detox ever. And what I mean is, I mean, let's put it this way. When you're eating heavy foods, right, which I was a pro at eating all these heavy, bulky, fatty foods,
mm-hmm.
when you have emotions that come up in your life and they rise up, well, I would notice that I would go and eat heavy foods and weigh them back down again. And then I'd play this game of, you know, a little while later, I might be getting stressed out from work, I might be depressed about something, the emotions kind of flare up again, I eat these heavy foods and it weighs it back down again. And so that was a normal process. But now you switch that to a raw food lifestyle and the emotions flare up, and eating a salad just doesn't do that great of a job of weighing down those emotions. So all of a sudden, stuff comes up, and you realize that you have one or two options. The first option, which a lot of people tend to do, is they go from raw to eating cooked and having something heavy that weighs that down. Then they go back to eating raw, and then eating cooked again because they can't deal with the emotion, weighing it back down. And generally, every time they play that transition, there's a little bit of extra guilt that gets added on that says, I couldn't do it, or I'm a failure. Mm-hmm. Usually that's not the best option. The second option, which I decided to go with, was I said, okay, this is coming up, the emotion's here. I don't even know what it's from. Is it from childhood? Is it from, you know, the present moment? I don't know. But I know that I need to let it go. I need to figure out ways to let this go. And so this emotional purging was going on. And, you know, I started getting into just, you know, reading some spiritual books and Eckhart Tolle and being in the present moment and not being afraid to cry and letting the emotion out and just being really real with myself. And in the beginning, it was a process. Like, I would try to have to figure out where everything was, like, coming from. Like, why am I upset? Is this from my parents getting separated? Is this from this and that? And after a while, I realized that I was putting too much attention on it. So I started this simple practice of acknowledgement and release. So when I felt the emotion come up, I would just acknowledge it. Like, I acknowledge the fact that I feel sad today, and I let it go. And I just would continue that process of acknowledging and letting go, as a lot of that emotion, childhood pain, trauma, you know, I mean, I've teased my entire life. I've only been able to shop at one store for like the second half of my life because no place had clothes that fit me. I mean, I used to be a 5 extra large shirt and a size 58 jeans.
Okay.
I mean, you just can't find that kind of clothes anywhere. I mean, and it just goes on and on. Just tons of insecurities and tics that I created, and just from being that size. And moving into letting all of that go once and for all was such a big thing for me. Now you switch that to juicing. Let me tell you, there's really nothing that weighs down those emotions. I mean, because it's just like you're drinking water practically. I mean, you have emotions. You're just not able to bury it with the food like you could with eating the standard American diet, or even eating raw and including nuts and things like that. So sometimes the emotion detox comes even more faster and furious. And it's just like, okay, here we go. And it's good, because once that's out, man, I mean, you feel refreshed, you feel renewed, you feel like a new person. I mean, I barely can remember who I was before I lost the weight. It almost feels like another lifetime ago.
Sure.
Yeah.
For some people just getting into this lifestyle, what would be some supplements or some tips or tricks that you could recommend for them to get, you know, make some quick gains?
Well, one of the things that I like to usually recommend, and you know, obviously switching 100% overnight is not something that, you know, is very feasible for most people, or most people will be able to do. So a simple method of working some more raw into your life and making some healthful changes is a process called the replacement method. And the replacement method is simply this. It says that, okay, I'm going to, and you pick a meal, I'm going to change my breakfast. Instead of having bacon and eggs every single morning, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to just learn how to make a great green smoothie, or substitute with fruit or something like that. And so you're adding something in your diet. You can have whatever you want for lunch, whatever you want for dinner. This is just one thing. That's it. And so you work at that for 4 to 6 weeks until it becomes a habit, until it becomes easy, until you don't feel like, oh, I'm making that, you know, smoothie in the morning, where you're kind of like, it feels like a struggle. No, this is just what you do every day now. This is part of your life. It's easy. And then when you feel really comfortable with that, you add in the next thing. How can I add in a wonderful salad for lunch? And then you create a habit out of that, and you keep playing that game until you finally realize, well, there's just not enough time in the day to eat all the garbage that wasn't serving me before and eat all this amazing healthy food. So, you know, just by a method of displacement, you displace the other stuff out, and you find yourself at a new space with these wonderful, wonderfully created habits that are really just assisting you and guiding you, and makes the transition a lot easier. And usually that works the best for people. It really gives them a slow pace, lets you feel grounded, and it doesn't feel like you have to do too much all at once.
Yeah. What would be a good recipe for a green smoothie?
You know, my favorite green smoothie recipe is very, well, it has a simple base, but then you can get excited with it if you want to. So what I like to do is I think of three things. One, I want to get my nutrients in there. So I either pack it with spinach or kale, or sometimes whatever other fun green that I can find that, you know, maybe just might be on sale that day or look, yeah, you know, really fresh that day. But I like to get in the dark greens. And, you know, I'm talking about, like, I usually do a whole bag of spinach or, you know, like 2-3 handfuls of kale. Some people could put a couple leaves in. I pack it in. Like, if we're going to have this and we're going to get the nutrients out of it, like, let's really pack it in. So, yeah. First of all, you got your greens. Second of all, you want to make it creamy. You want to make it yummy. You know, you don't want to just be chomping on lettuce leaves in there. So I usually go with a banana.
Okay.
And depending on how you are with sugar, you can do 1 to 2 bananas, and that's going to make it creamy. So first, we got our greens. Second, we got the creaminess. And then third, you might have some, you might want a little bit more of a sweet taste. And I like to put in either mango or blueberries or pineapple. Blueberries probably my favorite. And I'll just mix some of that in there. So again, you got your greens, you got your bananas for smoothiness, and you got whatever fruit you want to make a sweet fruit. And I usually just have some frozen fruit, or I'll get fresh fruit and then I'll just freeze it. It's nice and cold when
sure.
you blend it up. The whole drink is cold.
Uh-huh.
But then, of course, you can play around from there. Like, I'll add a little bit of sea salt, which brings out some of the flavor. I'll add some carob because I love the taste of carob. It tastes chocolatey, but it doesn't have the caffeine in it. And I'll add maca root for that stamina,
right.
Sometimes I'll add a little bit of green powder in there as well.
Okay.
Depending on, and then of course my Sun Warrior protein powder,
yeah.
I like to get in there, especially if it's an after workout. But those are all, again, optional. You know, another optional thing that's kind of fun is if you find you're drinking your smoothies too fast, you can add a little pinch of cayenne in there, and that's sure to slow down your consumption a little bit. And unless you're like me, I love cayenne, so I can just drink it straight.
But right.
It's kind of a fun thing. So you have your base smoothie, and then you have these other things that you can kind of add in as fun little options if you really want to make it, you know, like a powerfully packed superfood smoothie.
Yeah, cool. So what's your daily protocol like these days? I know it's always, you know, people ask me the same thing, and it changes from day to day, but what's the where's the trend going for you right now?
Sure. Well, I definitely enjoy keeping it as light as possible. So my main things that I eat are 4 items, and it's going to be juice, smoothies, soups, and salads.
Okay.
After about 5 years, 5.5 years, I did start to transition in some cooked foods. So during the winter, I was experimenting with tonic soups, which is something fun.
Cool.
Which some people are now getting into. Basically, if you've heard about making tonic teas or medicinal teas. I know in a previous episode you had Kurt on, and he was talking about his reishi mushrooms and herb in the chaga and all that stuff and how great that is. So you can make a tea, and then you drain out the mushrooms and all that, and you have the broth, and then you can put in root vegetables in there. You want to get fun, you can throw in artichoke, you can throw in different things like that.
Yeah.
And basically you make the soup. And then what we do is we'll take the soup. When that's all done, we'll put it in the blender, and then we'll add greens in it. So we'll add in like arugula, something really, I mean, just something packed with nutrients, a little bit bitter,
yeah.
Maybe a little bit of coconut oil. We'll blend that up.
Cool.
And in the end, you have this warm, tonic, green soup. I mean, medicinal. I mean, it's just ridiculous. It goes through your whole body, and you feel just amazing. So that's kind of a neat way that I like to sort of get in a little bit of a cooked warm element if that's something that I'm
sure.
looking for, or if something that your listeners are looking to transition into a little bit. But it's a creative way because you're not necessarily like eating chunks of stuff. It's blended with the greens, and you're getting the same amount of you know, high impact, I believe, you know, especially combining the tonic tea with it. And it's just out of this world.
Yeah. Any probiotics or fermented foods?
I do Sun Warrior's probiotic ormus greens,
oh, yes.
Which I like to mix in my soups, which is really fun. But besides that, I mean, man, I gotta say, I love kombucha. I love Rejuvelac. I don't really get into Rejuvelac too much just because I'm not in one place enough to make it.
Yeah.
But if I can find it in the stores, I'm all about the Rejuvelac. For those of you that haven't tried that, it smells like pickle juice, but it tastes like lemonade. It's kind of interesting.
And what's it made from?
I think we would do that with wheat berries and water. You know, it's been so long.
Yeah, I think
the
that's
last
it.
Time I made it was about 4.5-5 years ago when I went to the raw food center in Michigan, actually.
Oh,
Creative
yes.
Health Institute. And they taught us how to make it there. But mainly kombucha has been my thing as of recent. And of course, like sauerkraut, kimchi. I mean, I'm an addict. When I make my own kraut at home in big pots, and you know, it comes out with like, you know, a gallon and a half by the time I'm done. And I usually blast through it in a week. I always refer to it as you know, you're going on the kraut diet, because I mean, the minute I'm done and my kraut's ready, it's just like my body's craving and I just want to eat so much of it. And by the end of the week, I'm like, wow, I've actually like lost an additional 5 pounds on top of it, because it just moves through your system and it's just so fantastic and just clears things out a bit. But I really am into I'm into that as well.
Have you ever gotten into colonics or enemas?
Yes, and I believe in them a lot. You know, there's some mixed feelings I think about it, mainly probably because people have had just such a poor idea in life about what it means to feel comfortable to, you know, touch yourself, I guess, in that regard.
Mm-hmm,
and
yeah.
You know, nobody wants to have the idea of like some tube in their butt, and
right.
That's what happens when you get a colonic or enema. But once you can get over that, you're fine, because I recently introduced two people to an enema in the past month, and just kept encouraging them and went out and bought them a bag and told them how to do it. And I was like, try it. And when they were done, they were just like literally it was like life change. It was almost like a light went off. And they were just like, wow, I feel so different. Like, I actually feel happier now, now that something's out of my body. I mean, literally, people sometimes have stuff stuck in their colon that's been there since childhood, you know? And it's just, I mean, I'm not going to get into it too much, but, you know, one of my good friends is a colon hydrotherapist, and she said all politicians should get colonics, you know, as a joke. But it's really serious, because you know, you feel amazing, especially if you haven't had it done before. And when you're going on a juice fast, you know, after a few days, you're not having, obviously, normal bowel movements because you're not eating mass amount of food. And colonics are mandatory because you're detoxing and you don't want all this toxic stuff to be stuck into your system. You want to be able to flush that out. So enemas at home, definitely. Colonics, you know, when you can afford them, or if you're doing any kind of juice fast or long juice fast, then, you know, as much as you can afford, most likely.
Yeah. Do you know of any people that do bentonite clays while doing a juice feast? Is that common at all?
Yeah, I think the only person that I know that's done that personally is my buddy Matt Monarch. I think he did a heavy series of that, like a 7-day series where he was pumping that out every day and doing 2 colonics a day too, which was madness. And he actually said he had almost like a euphoric, blissful experience where he felt like he was just sort of lifting off the ground, so to speak.
Yeah.
And I mean, there's people that get into that a bit. And I mean, you know, you hear stories about people who are so bloated and then they have these colonics or do a bentonite clay or whatever that, it, you know, and they've even talked about rings like literally sliding off people's fingers because they're so bloated.
Oh.
And you know, and it's just an interesting thing because it's still, I think it's still fairly untapped, because a lot of doctors don't understand, like regular doctors don't understand it, and they don't normally recommend it. And it's kind of surprising because I've found lots of value from it, especially clearing away a lot of the stuff that's just been there for years. And, you know, some people even have worms and different things that come out, and next thing you know it, their eating pattern's different, because before they could eat and eat and eat and eat and eat, and nothing ever satisfied them, and they might have been skin and bones, but they can still keep eating and eating and not realizing that there's other things that can be at play there.
Yeah, parasites. Okay, so since you lost all the weight, you said that your activity level really, really bumped up a lot. So what kind of stuff do you do during the day, you know, to keep busy, stay off your feet, on your feet?
Sure.
I mean, yeah.
Sure. Well, the first year I didn't do any exercise when I lost the weight, and then after I had year was over, I said, okay, it's time for me to incorporate something into my life. And of course, everybody had suggestions as they normally do. Oh, you need to do, you know, go to the gym. You need to do this many reps and this many weights and, you know, this many sets and all this stuff. And I knew that if I found something that wasn't going to be appealing for me, I wasn't going to do it. It was going to be like anything else. I was going to try it for 3 weeks and I was going to be done with it. So I said, okay, I have to figure out something I like to do that involves movement. I don't care what it is. I don't even care if it's just ping pong. I have to find something. And I decided to go out and do hiking, which was perfect for me. I didn't want to run down the street and, you know, 300 pounds and have everybody looking at me. Hiking, I'm like in the woods. Nobody can see me. I'm surrounded by trees. My breathing's better. And so I started with that. And then I did that the whole next year as I lost that second 100 pounds. And then after I had lost that weight, I said, okay, this is pretty fun. Now I'm actually excited to do some weightlifting and excited to do push-ups and things like that. So I've been in an experimentation phase. I've done everything from the P90X workout, which I know you've mentioned before. I did that for a couple months. I mean, literally the best shape I ever was in my life.
Yeah.
Super trim. Yeah. I just was doing things physically that I didn't even, that I've never been able to do in my life, ever, even when I was younger. Mm-hmm. So that was amazing. Two, being on the move and not being able to do that and getting in a lot of, you know, body weight exercises. And so that's what I really enjoy the most right now, I think. Just getting in push-ups. I mean, I kind of play this game, and I've done this with, you know, my buddy Drew, who you mentioned, and other friends too, is we'll just, anytime throughout the day we think about push-ups, we have to just stop and do 20. So it could be like the way to the bathroom. It could be, you know, you've been on the computer for a half hour and just, okay, quick 20-minute break. Let's just drop down and do push-ups, you know, get back up. And then you find out, wow, I've done, you know, 10 sets of 20 today, or 20 is easy now. I can do sets of 30, or let's try different things. Instead of traditional push-ups, you know, let's try like diamond push-ups or, you know, different types of things that are working different areas. So I've been really getting into that, and that really helps when traveling because, you know, I mean, between doing that and kind of crunches, and sometimes I still take my P90X disc with me. Actually, I have it right here with me, and I'll just do the ab workout too. So I'll put my push-ups, and then I'll do a quick 15-minute ab workout with a variety of different crunches and leg exercises that are all, you know, focusing on the abs and stuff like that. And that tends to be nice. Now, I've been up here in Jasper, Alberta, and it's just, I mean, it's like God's country up here. It's just so amazing that I've just been putting in walks all the time. I mean, six miles is easy. I don't even blink because it's great. The person that I'm with doesn't have a car. The town's like a couple miles away. Anytime you want something to eat or do anything fun, you know, it's just, you just walk. And so I try to get in as walking as much as possible. I mean, I try to incorporate all the little things. Like, you know, when I'm at the airport and, you know, you have to go to the next gate, I don't stand on the moving sidewalks, I walk. Yeah. And when there's the escalator or the stairs, you know, I take the stairs. And when I'm in a building, when it's the elevator or stairs, I take the stairs, you know, making simple choices. Like, I don't have to be in the closest parking space in front of Whole Foods. I can park in the back and I can walk to the door.
Right.
You know, so kind of just creating a lifestyle of exercise a little bit more than like, okay, from this time to this time, I'm going to do this. From this time to this time, I'm going to do this. No, it's just like, I always want to be moving. I always want to be working out. Even when I'm watching a movie, sometimes I'll just sit down on the ground and do stretches and get my flexibility where I want it to be and drop down and do a couple push-ups and sit back up and kind of always just being active. So it's kind of a state of being active. And, you know, my vibe, you know, if you ever check out Vibram shoes, is like, I wear those all the time and they just make me want to be even more active. Just walking down the street, I want to climb on things and jump on things.
Yeah.
Somebody's like, go bike riding? Yeah, okay. We're going to go hiking? Sure, I'm there, you know. And it's just, it's fun. It's creating a lifestyle of health and exercise and enjoyment.
Yeah, yeah. So how many books do you have published now? How many have you written?
Thanks for asking. I just actually finished my fourth book. So I first started off with Raw Food, Fast Food, which was basically like simple recipes, 10 minutes or less.
Okay.
And then it went to Raw Food Salad Bar, which was simple soups and salads, because people find that soups and salads tend to be the bulk of what they eat after they go in raw for a while.
Mm-hmm.
And then I wanted to do a dessert book. So myself and my friend Heather Pace, we did a raw food carob desserts, and we really wanted to introduce carob in a big way and decided to launch the first raw food book about it for those that have trouble with chocolate and aren't so interested in having the caffeine, now that we can make a bunch of desserts with that. And then most recently, I just finished a raw food juice bar with my friend Natalia KW, and that's just amazing, beautiful juice recipes that are exciting and fun. And you know, I'm big into juicing. I promote it. I host a juicing event every so often up in Canada as well, where mm-hmm. people can come and detox. So yeah, I'm really excited about this most recent one, and it's been getting a lot of good reviews.
That's so cool. If someone wants to get that, where would you suggest they get it from?
Yeah, they can just check me out on philipmccluskey.com. All my stuff's on Amazon. I sell it for less expensive. So again, check it out there, or if, you know, also you can get the ebook version for less if,
cool.
if you're interested in being a little bit more eco.
So. Yeah, that's a really good idea. So now you're going to Australia, and then what are your plans after Australia? Are you coming back to the States or Europe?
So one of the things that I'm really excited about is I'm going to Australia, and as I'm going there, I'm kicking off a new program. Finally, after working on a program for years, I created a 7-week at-home complete weight loss, full life transformation program. It's called World's Sexiest Diet. And there's also going to be a book coming as well, The World's Sexiest Diet. People can check that out, worldsexiestdiet.com. So I'm going to start cool. touring in the States specifically for that, because so many people, I mean, the biggest question that obviously I get from somebody who's lost over 200 pounds is, you know, how do I do it? And, you know, a lot of people will bring up things and say, I've tried this and that. And, you know, the funny thing is there's a lot of diets out there that have been created by skinny people who don't understand the plight of really losing weight.
Good point.
And that's kind of what I get into. I address the emotional issues and give you the keys to transform. And we talk about the 7 secrets to sexy and how to, you know, get your outside and the inside sexy so you can feel that self-love and really transform your life. So I'm going to be on tour for that. So we're doing this Australian tour, and then I'll be just bouncing back and probably moving right out to the West Coast, after February, and continuing on there.
How long are you going to stay in Australia?
2 months.
Okay.
Yeah.
Like you're going to hit the West Coast, East Coast, both of them, and.
I think we're going to try to hit Perth. It's a bit of a stretch, man. It's just
it's a big
just
country.
A hike, but but most likely the East Coast, definitely Sydney and in Brisbane, hopefully Byron Bay and Adelaide and around there.
Cool. You should see if you can find some there's a lot of food forests and permaculture people out there, and I'm sure mm-hmm. it would be a good place to host a talk if possible. Maybe talk to your connection out there who's getting everything lined up, and she might know of some good permaculture people, because that's the best place
definitely.
For it.
Yeah, and there's some cool you know, Aboriginal you know, just wonderful, wonderful people and events and things going on. And I love getting into there. You know, I'm not so much into the whole tourist scene. Like, I like to get into the heart of what's going on. And if I can get, you know, get up to New Zealand and check out some
cool.
Maoris on the way back, man, that'll be a wrap for me. I'm looking forward to that. I also plan having a good time there. I booked my one of my people that I love to watch, musicians, is Jason Mraz, and
mm-hmm.
I booked tickets at the Sydney Opera House there.
Whoa.
And we're gonna go skydiving. So this is all about kind of like merging business into pleasure, and so it's not business anymore or not pleasure. It's just life, and it's just kind of what we do and what we enjoy.
Well put.
And it's a bit of a mix of everything, which makes it quite wonderful.
Yeah, you know, you're gonna be pretty close to Bali as well, so if possible,
yes.
I would highly recommend Bali.
I've had my friend Suki's over there.
Yeah,
right.
She's
always just like, are you gonna come to Bali? Are you gonna come to Bali?
So you probably should.
I'm not sure yet.
I mean, it's really probably, I don't know, a 3-hour flight from Australia. You know, once you're that far over, you might as well do what you can. But all right,
yeah.
Very cool, very cool. So before we break, if you could give the guests, or not the gear of the guests, but if you could give the viewers maybe like 3 books that you would recommend, you know, just like 3 books that you've read in your life that really made a big difference, even 2 books, just something
sure.
that they could go on.
I would probably say if I was going to pick 2 books right now, well, I can give you 3 books. First one would be definitely The Power of Now by Eckhart Tolle. Love Eckhart's work. And it's really helped me release a lot of the emotional stuff and come back to the present moment, come back to now. And, you know, just to take life a little bit easier. You know, the second book I actually have right here, and I go through this a couple times. This would be one for the men, but it's also one for actually anybody. The Way of the Superior Man is fantastic. And I just read this one over and over again. That'll, you know, guys, that's a little bit of a reminder on what it's like to be, you know, a guy. And then women, it's kind of like women check that book out as well, because it gives you a little bit of understanding on how we tick. And so those are a couple great books. That one deals with a little bit more relationships, obviously. Eckhart's a bit more spiritual matter. And you know, another one which I really, really love is The Way of the Peaceful Warrior. Mm-hmm. I know they made it into a movie, which was all right, but the book was just fantastic, and that's by Dan Millman. And I used to read that book over every single year just to inspire me to face fears and overcome and you know, really go for it in life. No deathbed regrets, you know. It's like saying yes to life and really embodying all that really means.
Awesome.
So that'd be my recommendations.
Very cool. So how can people find you? Facebook, Twitter, where are you on the internet?
Sure. Twitter, my name, philipmccluskey.com, philipmccluskey. I have a Facebook fan page. It's facebook.com/philipmccluskey and then the number 7, philipmccluskey7. Or my website, philipmccluskey.com. A lot of people might have known me from my previous website name, which was Loving Raw. You can type in Loving Raw, you can type in my name. Either way gets you there. You'll be able to see all my posts, tons of free videos and hundreds of blogs and a fully complete raw food online store. So yeah, there's a bunch of different ways you can check me out.
Awesome, brother. Well, cool, man. Thank you so much for coming on the show. I really appreciate your time and your presence.
My pleasure. Thank you so much for all you guys are doing.
Yeah. I'll see you when you get back. Have a good time.
All right.
All right.
Good.
Take it easy, Phil. Peace. Later, man. All right, everyone. Thanks so much. That was Philip McCluskey. He's a big hero of mine. He's made some major gains. I mean, major gains. Stuff that, you know, I don't even forget the guy's name from Subway, but it's like, that stuff's like irrelevant to me. Like, what Philip's been doing completely overshadows that. So check him out for sure. And check us out on onlyonetv.com. And we'll see you really soon. Take care. Thanks a lot. Peace. Thank you.